Settle down. Come on in. Come on in and grab a seat, everyone. This is a very, very critical part of our whole event, which is happening right now. Thank you for the cowbell. Please come in and get settled down. Come on in, guys. Thank you. Come on in. All right, great. We'll get started. So everybody, it is my great pleasure to introduce to you all Lorena Altamirano. So we have been working very, very closely with MIT's safety department and EHS. And I really just want to personally thank you, Lorena, so, so much. Again, to have an event like this happen and to be able to organize all of the different types of wet lab activities and hands-on activities and demos and so on, we really, really had to work very closely with MIT on the highest levels of safety. And Lou is here someplace. Thank you so much to Lou and EHS. And Lorena, you've been such a powerful advocate. Lorena basically was such a critical person in helping to make so much of this happen today. So what we're going to do right now is we're going to play a game, okay? So critically, take out your cell phones and your devices because we're going to do biosafety, but in a way that I personally have never done it before, and I'm very excited to see how Lorena is going to do this. So can we just give a warm round of applause and welcome to Lorena, please. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Good morning, everyone. Buenos dias. Buenos dias. Yeah, I know. I met a couple of people that speak Spanish, my native language. I am a biosafety officer here at MIT, and I usually want to get acquainted with my audience, my captive audience today. So by a show of hands, how many of you have a biological training background? Ooh, my sort of people. I'm a trained biologist too. How many of you have worked in a sort of an academic lab or an industry type lab? Very good. Okay, so we're gonna have fun today. As David said, today we're gonna review some basic concepts in biosafety. And we're gonna do it by playing a quiz game. So let me see. Please open your browser and go to either any web browser and go to Kahoot.it. I'm gonna show you the PIN number in a second, and you're gonna be able to enter a nickname. But first, I just want to go over our objectives for today. As I'm assuming all of you have a certain knowledge of biological risk, today we're going to gain awareness and identify some of the hazards that you're going to be seeing or even handling in the laboratory. And we're going to learn, better say, I am going to make sure you guys understand the concept of personal protective equipment. Here at PPE, we love letters and numbers to call things, so we call it PPE. So you go to the lab with your supervisors and your teaching assistants and David and Manny. They are going to be providing you this PPE to do your work in the laboratory. And of course, it's important for you to know how to react in emergency. So we're going to review briefly those things for MIT. Okay, I'm assuming you're all seeing this screen on your phones. Enter the number 346547, and then you can have fun with a nickname. Also, while you do that, there's gonna be a clipboard, or maybe more than one, going around. Find your name there and put your signature. That's gonna be the documentation for our training today. Excellent. So I was told we are about 200 people strong today. Will that be accurate, more or less? This is a very nice group. Okay, so we need to see where, that's the number of players, so we need to have as many people as we can. And then we are going to start. Any questions? No? Great. Okay. Anybody else having trouble with a website? No? We should start. As far as I know, you can log in at any time if you enter that PIN number to join us. But we seem to be going. Okay. If you don't have a phone or a device, a web device, you can join with someone and play the game in pairs or groups. That would be fun too. Okay, here goes. First question is coming. What are the risks with working with living organisms and or recombinant nucleic acids? That's a good one. I may ask why. So you have about 20 seconds. So take your time and read. Everything may make sense, right? Very, very good. Yes. At this event, after our risk assessment, which we work very closely with David to do, we have considering that contamination may be the biggest risk you may go through in the laboratory. There's certainly nothing infectious that you are working with right now. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Now, as a public health professional, as biosafety officers, we are worried about contamination leaving the laboratory space, right? Like leaving the containment area. So we want you to make sure you do certain things to prevent that from happening. And the most effective way to preventing contamination on yourselves of infection or lack of containment is washing your hands. So keep that in mind, okay? Next question. You guys have done excellent. And we already have, this thing keeps a scoreboard, so, woohoo! Vortex, yes. How can you be exposed to microorganisms and or recombinant nucleic acids? Extra points for those that know who the guy is on the picture. Very good. So if you hit one, you were right. All of the ways in which you can be exposed are listed there. The most common we see as biosafety officers in laboratories at MIT, not that it's going to be an issue with you guys, is sharps and splashes. Any questions about that? I don't expect you to be exposed through any of these routes of exposure in the laboratory. So this is a way to make you aware of it. Next question. Juicizes. Did I say it correctly? A biosafety level one can be defined as, this is the lowest biosafety level out there. It usually applied to organisms that are not dangerous, therefore usually are not associated with disease or infections. So that's a clue. Excellent. Yes. It is defined as working with organisms that are not known to cause disease in healthy adult humans. Also, at this biosafety level, and you're going to experience this in the laboratory, you can do work with minimum personal protective equipment. In your case, that will be a lab coat and gloves.
Next question. Heather.
What are effective controls at biosafety level 1 to protect you from contamination / infection? And remember, we talked about personal protective equipment. You're all right. The main things that you're going to see in the laboratory and for the demos and experiments you're going to use is your gloves and a lab coat. Also, if there's going to be pipetting or drawing liquids from devices, you're going to be using a mechanical pipetting device. Now, how many of you know, based on some of the work with microorganisms that you're going to be doing, what is the most effective disinfectant against E. coli? Show of hands. Bleach. I see another hand over there. Anybody else have other options? Ethanol. Yes, ethanol. Bleach is the most stringent. 10% final volume of household bleach. 70% ethanol is very effective also against E. coli. And I believe that's the disinfectant that you're going to see in the laboratory. Questions about that?
Good. Heather, good Heather. Next question.
What is the most effective habit to prevent contamination and infection? We do have rules in the lab of not eating and drinking. Since you all have a biological background, so I'm assuming you have a basic level of microbiological technique, not touching your face is ideal. We haven't been able to prevent that from happening yet. Excellent. Washing your hands, according to the CDC, is the most effective method to prevent contamination and infection. So after your wonderful demos, today and over the weekend in the laboratory, we will recommend you that after removing your gloves, that you wash your hands before leaving the laboratory. Heather is unbeatable, huh? You see a biohazard sign on something, let's say a piece of equipment. What do you do next? And the biohazard sign at MIT looks just like that. It's an action. It's a reflex for some of you, or both, most of you. Good. Good, good, good. So some of you decided not to touch and ask for information about the hazard. That is perfect. That is actually perfect. What is it? I'll give you points for that, okay? I'll give you points for that. But we expect you in the laboratory to stop, look for those gloves that should be distributed among the benches and put gloves on. That's at the minimal level, right? So you can approach the object that has that biohazard label carefully. So are you guys enjoying the game? Is it tough or is it easy? You need to get together with Heather, I guess. What is proper attire to attend laboratory? Very good. Closed-toe shoes and long pants. Excellent. You're going to be provided with lab coat and gloves over there. Whoever said that no attire required, the risk is minimum, is partially true too. But you actually need to know in depth the risks associated with the material that you're going to be working with. Despite the fact that it's low risk, you still have to comply with the rules of the environment, right? So in this laboratory, as soon as you see a BO1 sticker outside the door, which I believe they all have, there are certain expectations of minimum PPE associated with that. Any questions?
Yeah, Heather.
She needs some kind of reward. What must you do if you get exposed to biological materials in the lab? And this is a sort of an emergency response here at MIT. Use more common sense to find your proper response here. I love the fact that nobody answers, "I do not know." That's excellent. Wash the affected area and tell supervisor immediately. That is the proper MIT response. Excellent, excellent. If you are in doubt, we want you to still go to wash by the sink. Use the eye wash that you're gonna see there. And if there are no people around or your supervisor is not there, tell anyone what happened. And information should filter through to the supervisor. Applause for Heather, please. Where's Heather? Excellent. Okay. To summon emergency assistant beyond the lab supervisor, you can use two methods here at MIT, and I'll give you this response. We have a landline phone number, 100. And then we have a number that you can program in your cell phone, 617-253-1212. That will take you to exactly the same source of emergency response. Very good. All of them are correct. Any questions in regards to that? And you guys are done. Heather is our winner for today. Oh, that's Heather, followed by Tuck and Isaac Pants. They did very well, too. You are going to see a brief survey at the end of the app. Would you please fill out that for me to see how effective this method of training it is? In the spirit of the Bio Summit, we wanted to hack learning in terms of biosafety and in terms of safety in general. So we're always trying to engage our audiences and make learning more fun. So thank you very much.
One more round of applause for Lorraine, everybody. Awesome. I will take this one. Number two, guys. Oh, awesome. Thank you. Okay, so the other critical thing that's going to happen right now, and I hope Nicole or somebody is aware. So we had hopefully some clipboards that were going around that you guys were signing. Did that happen? Okay, I don't think that happened. So hopefully, can somebody alert? Hey, Thrus, can you alert somebody at the info point just to come over? Because one thing, before you guys can get into the lab, you have to sign this clipboard that's gonna go around. So let me just make sure Nicole or somebody gets it. Anyways, we'll pass it around over the course of the next session. So just make sure everybody at your table signs it and then we'll be good to go for our first hands-on workshops later today, okay? So Peter and Co, are we ready for the next set of talks? You guys ready to go? All right, cool. So I'm gonna invite up next two homies. We got the dude Jason Bobe and the man Todd Kuchen. So everybody make some noise for Jason and for Todd. Okay, yes. Yes. This is JT. I just came up with a nickname for you guys. So Jason and Todd have both been really, really instrumental also in helping to organize this conference. They've been really, again, a big, big part of the DIY bio movement over the past bunch of years and just have been forces of nature and really, really, for me, great mentors and learning a lot about how to organize an event like this. Jason does this all the time. So Jason, thank you again for all of your help in making this event happen, and same with you, Todd. So the floor is yours.
Well, I'm going to start things off just 4 or 5 minutes. But before I do, how lucky is this community to have David? So I'm just going to focus on the origins of the codes. And I don't know if you know this is trivia, but the above the DIY by logo, those are actually safety goggles. And this came out of a crucible period of this movement around 2008 and to 2011. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that. So next slide. Do I have an ability to do that, or do I like pull my ear? So how many people in this room were at the first DIY Bio meetup? I think it might just be Kim. Romy was there. So this was at Asgard's Pub in Cambridge, just down the road from here. I like half of the people at this meetup were at actually Ginkgo founders, it turns out. And we spent a lot of time just meeting with other people with the idea that we wanted to have a community. And this was before there were community labs. We had a notion that there should be public labs, is what we called them at first, and then became community labs. So before there were actually community labs, and there was just the very early stages of a community, we went to public spaces. And so I have no idea what we're doing here. This is the top of a parking garage. That's Kay All, who's amazing and had a lab in her closet. And so we'd come outside every now and then and get people together and do things. And so we did a lot of surveying of microbes and sequencing of microbes in the early days of barcoding and 16S. And so the other place that we did our work was in art galleries. And so this was in LA at an exhibit called XYZ and U. And so we came up with this. This is Matt Cowell, who was really responsible for the early energy of this movement and the community in Boston, and was an amazing spirit. Is an amazing spirit today. But the difference between Bacillus subtilis and anthrax is one nucleotide change. And so we had people stamp out the 16S gene and show like which nucleotide was different. And we had a lot of fun. I also had a terrible mustache during that period. That's gone away. And then things really changed. By the end of the year, we got, Carolyn Johnson wrote a front page Boston Globe article. The headline was, "Hackers Want to Make Science Accessible to Everyone." And my girlfriend's father at the time sat me down and said, "I understand that you're a biohacker, and you know I was a priest, and I'm here to help if you need help." That was the view of what it was. And the Jim Lehrer PBS came in and said, "Hey, we want to do an interview with you guys." And the first question was, "What is DIY Bio?" And Mac is totally brilliant. You should go to YouTube and watch this video. Brian Bishop grabbed it and put it online. You can Google for it. Mac was like, "Well, we don't actually really know what it is. We're getting people together. We're talking about it. We have some ideas about what it should be, what it could be." And the next question is it safe? And they were like just trying to shut us down before we even talk about what our dreams and hopes and dreams were. And this was a pattern that continued. This was the crucible for the next 3 years, is that when anybody talked about biohacking and DIY bio in the media and the public sphere, this is sort of the flavor of what people thought it was. And so, and this was sort of the origin of, let's get a bunch of people who want to build this community and figure out what our values are, because people are telling our story for us, and we need to actually, people who are looking into this community from the outside, this is what they see. And so how do we actually establish to the outside world what our values are? And so what are our values? And so we got a bunch of people together. And so in terms of like codes, there's lots of reasons for codes of why people make them. These are some of them. Those were ours historically. And there are three types of codes. Just so you know, aspirational codes, you know, do no harm, the Hippocratic Oath, educational codes, you know, the Society of vertebrate paleontology says, don't buy and sell T-Rex bones, unless you're going to put them in a public trust. There's the enforceable codes, NIH government grants. We're only going to give you money if you put the data in the public domain, those kinds of things. And of course, we were shooting for aspirational codes. And actually now we have, in the, across the community labs, people have all different kinds of these. These codes exist in the community now in different forms across community labs. There are labs, if you are aggressive to other members, you can get banned permanently and across all labs, like in the Bay Area, things like that. And so now I'm going to hand it over to Todd, who I met. I just pulled up the very first email in LA in 2010. And this was during this period where we said, hey, let's get some people together and talk about what our values are. And so Todd's going to walk you through what that process was like.
Todd. Yeah. Thanks, Jason. So, yeah, so when Jason and I met, we were sort of talking and we sort of asked, you know, what would it be like if we got the community at the time together to see kind of what kind of some of these aspirational codes might be if they wanted to even develop some. And so we had a graphic recorder in Europe. So this is what the process looked like, basically. And I'm just going to go through quickly to kind of show you some pictures and sort of how the process went. This was the group in Europe at the time that we brought together. Anyone, there's a couple people here. Anyone here that was at that first coding workshop? No, a couple? Anyway, but look how awesome it is now, the fact that there's 200 people here now that we can have sort of another larger discussion about this. But basically, over a couple of days, like Jason was saying, we were just talking about the, you know, the community's hopes and fears about what the community was up to, what the community wanted to be, where the community wanted to go. And basically, over those couple of days, we had lots of different discussions about those topics. And in essence, we sort of collated them into, in essence, different types of aspirational statements. There's lots of them here. You're not supposed to be able to sort of read all of those. And then over multiple different rounds and discussions, the community in Europe narrowed those down into this code of ethics from 2011. How many people have seen this before? Some people, not a lot, okay. So this is up on diybio.org. So you can go on here and sort of read what the community at the time came together with and decided what some of those aspirational goals might be. We then repeated that exercise in the US. Jason and I both dug around forever. We could not find any pictures from that. We're wondering if we didn't take any because maybe people didn't want them taken or we just lost them is probably the really what happened. But in essence, the process was the same. We talked about sort of the hopes and the fears of the community. And this was sort of the result of that process. Again, they came up with lots of different principles. Again, we developed this big, long list of aspirational goals. And over time, the community was voting on those, and then they developed this set. If you actually compare the two, they're relatively similar, which was sort of an awesome and interesting thing that happened, because we didn't actually share with the two groups what the other groups were coming with, because we wanted it to be an organic process and people to develop their own codes. So where are we now? So obviously the community has gotten a lot larger, and so what we want to do over the next couple of days is have a big discussion about what sort of the future of these codes might look like. Do we still want codes of ethics for the community? Should they be for the entire community? Should they be for individual labs? Should they be regionally? Should they be by country? These are all open questions we want to have a conversation about over the next couple of days. So if you haven't seen it, there's a code wall out in right outside in the room there. We've got the original codes there on pieces of paper, and in essence, we want people to cut them up, remix them, adapt them, and use all of those sticky notes. Just shout out to Megan, we're gonna use sticky notes. Put the sticky notes up on the wall, and over the next couple of days, we're gonna just sort of reorganize, take a look at what they look like, and on Sunday, if we can pull it all together, we'll kind of have that big sort of spreadsheet-looking thing or something similar, and then we've got stickers that we're gonna see sort of what people think about that, and then we'll send this back out to the community, and we'll see what the community sort of wants to do in terms of what our aspirational goals are or what they aren't. So that's all we got. It's awesome to be here. It's awesome to see how big this community has gotten and how much bigger it's going to get moving forward. So thanks a lot.
One more time for Jason and Todd, everybody. Okay, So, okay, so that's going to be a really, really important activity. And again, I think, you know, we were just chatting with Lorena and other folks thinking about safety. And I think, you know, having these cultural norms is such a big, big part of how we're going to be able to do bio in a safe way. So, you know, thanks so much again, Jason and Todd, for your previous work and also the work that we're going to do together this weekend. So thanks so much, guys. So again, as part of this sort of foundational activity, in one of those kind of organizing meetings, we were like, hey, you know, it'd also be really cool and interesting for us to think about, you know, the term biohacker, right? Again, I think if you asked everybody in the room here, people might have a different definition of what that actually means. And I think these terms, you know, they're really important. And, you know, I'm very, very excited to hear from Maria, who's been thinking a little bit about a type of activity that we can do together to try and define, redefine, and put some meaning behind that term. So everybody, please, a round of applause in welcoming Maria Chavez.
Hi, everybody. I don't have any slides. This is going to be not too long. So what I find interesting is when you get people together, even amongst my community at BioCurious, we don't have a common thing we all call ourselves. So there's been a constant push and pull even amongst our board members. Are we biohackers? Are we community biologists, community researchers, or scientists? So riffing off of that, one of the things I'd like to do with all of you, since we have such great members of the international community, is come up with a really good definition of what does it mean to be a biohacker and what does it mean to do biohacking. And this is something I want us to be able to share. And I don't think we're going to agree, but at least we can try to define it. So right now, there are four main areas that people talk about when they're thinking about biohacking. So one of the first of these areas is going to be when people are doing body modifications. So I know we've got a couple people here who are in the body mod community who are doing things like implantables, and they're the grinders. So that's one subset of biohacking. Another subset of our biohacking community are those of us who are doing synthetic biology. So people who are trying to hack biology, who are out there. Some people are doing a subset of that, DIY biology, so the do-it-yourself biologists. And the last one is the one I most want to address with us as a group, and this is mostly going to happen on the unconference. We're bringing it up now because I want you all to be thinking about this. How do we deal with the idea that biohacking is basically mad scientists? So it's the negative aspect. So people who say, oh no, I don't want to be associated with that term, biohacking, because, you know, hackers are bad. So how do we reclaim this idea? How do we change our image? How do we define what we do and how we're doing it? So over the course of the weekend, around the corner from where Todd's wall is, on the other side of it, is a small section of wall. Please put some post-it notes. Please fill in, what is your definition of biohacker? What is your definition of biohacking? And then on Sunday, we're going to gather up those definitions and work through it as a working group. That's about it.
Awesome. Thank you, Maria. Okay, so something that I completely did not think was gonna happen at all, like at all, this is the last thing I thought was gonna happen. We're ahead of time. We're my mind is blown. And we're even going to be a little more ahead of time because, unfortunately, I just got word from Marshall that, so he's in DC right now running another big workshop in parallel. So things got a little crazy and we're going to have to readjust the schedule. So Marshall isn't able to join us now. So, but very quickly, what I just wanted to do is to give a shout out for Marshall and what's going to happen. So at some point, Saturday, Sunday, we're going to get him back in here to talk a little bit about his organizing experience. And again, I think, you know, already today, this idea of are we a movement has been a really, really great question. I was just chatting with Rowan in the back, and Rowan's like, dude, of course this is a movement, right? Like, look at all the people, look at you all making all of the effort to travel all around the world to be here in this room, right? And, you know, just to say, too, you know, in organizing this conference, we probably pulled together a conference that You know, this conference should have taken like a year to organize probably, and we tried to do it in like 3 or 4 months. And in doing so, that meant that a lot of the people that wanted to come internationally weren't able to make it. So we had a lot of issues with visas and embassies and people getting denied and so on. And you know, those are all, for me personally, a lot of great learning experiences so that the next time we try to organize an event like this, we can do this with, you know, a lot more advanced warning to try and make sure that those folks that we really, really wanted to get here could be here. I want to shout out, if they're watching on the live stream right now, Alex and Harry. Alex and Harry are two young people that are in Ghana. They have been trying so, so hard to get here to this event. We did everything that we could. We bought their plane tickets, gave them these, you know, documents, all the stuff, and you know, the U.S. Embassy was still like, no, you kids can't come. So we are thinking, you know, about how to do better next time, but we're also going to have them join us on Sunday. So I don't know if Connie Chow is here, but Connie is doing great work in Ghana through an entity called the Exploratory. And so Alex and Harry are going to come and join us then. And if you guys are watching the live stream right now, Alex and Harry, give me a round of applause and shout out to Alex and Harry in Ghana right now, who can't be here. Yeah, we're thinking about you guys, and you guys are loved and thought of and part of this community. And again, I don't have the list in front of me, but there's a whole number of folks that also just couldn't be here that, again, due to visa situations and other situations, just couldn't make it. So next time we'll be better, and we'll make sure we can get them here. So because we have a little bit of extra time, I'm just still shocked. What we can do right now actually is just do a little bit of Q&A. I kind of like ran through a lot of logistical stuff in the first half hour or 20 minutes, like really quickly. So I'll just pause right now and, you know, lunch is at 12. What time is it right now? It's 11:40. Okay, so we can just do question Q&A for a few minutes. If anybody has any logistical questions or wants to talk about anything, really. Sabrina is over there. That's Sabrina with a microphone. And Liza, where's Liza? Over here on the other side. So does anybody have any questions about logistics related to the event or just something you want to share? Okay, Eddie, if it's in the front.
Sabrina can come
over here to Eddie. Maybe. Shout until the mic comes. Yeah, go ahead.
What are you expecting in terms of organization of the unconference components?
Ah, great, great point. Okay, awesome question. So again. You want to say it again? Say it again. Yeah, go for it, Eddie.
What are you expecting in terms of organization of the unconference sessions?
All right, great question. Okay, so the logistics for that are as follows. And I don't know if anybody from Innovation Endeavors is here, but yes, Marshall, is that you? Marshall, woo! Shout out to Innovation Endeavors and Marshall. Yeah. Okay, so I participated in this really, really amazing set of unconferences at this event called Camp Curiosity, which Innovation Endeavors organizes in the woods in California. And basically, we kind of just borrowed their stuff. So Ali was so cool, was like, yeah, borrow our stuff. So that whole kind of document you guys filled out, that template was borrowed straight up from Innovation Endeavors. And so we also used the same strategy for the unconference wall. So, but we did a little bio twist, okay? So this is the twist. Again, thanks to Joey Ito, Joey has this like amazing collection of like plush bacteria stuffed animals, although it's kind of funny because they're not stuffed animals, right? But whatever. So these stuffed plush bacterial toys, and so Nicole and some team right now, I think, are like mounting those toys onto sticks, okay? Trust me, this is going somewhere. All right, and so what's going to happen is, okay, when we, especially on Sunday, there's going to be multiple unconferences that will happen at the same time, for example. So, and they're going to launch each hour. So what will happen is, let's say it's 12 o'clock, right? We'll look, there may be 3 or 4 parallel unconferences. If you have an unconference at 12 o'clock, you're going to get on stage and be like, hey, I'm Eddie, and I've got a really cool unconference on X. And if you're interested in it, come and follow me, and you'll be holding a stick with a certain bacteria on it, and you'll say, come follow me to wherever, and you're going to walk, and you're going to lead the group that's interested in that unconference to whatever room you're going to go into, okay? So we'll have as many sticks as there are parallel unconferences, so each of you pitch your unconference for a minute, and then lead to whatever area you want to take it to, okay? And again, we've got all kinds of great spaces. You go out to the terrace, you can go out into the lysosome, into the Golgi complex, etc. The one other kind of key logistical element is, again, going back to the FOMO, not everybody is going to be able to experience everything. So in parallel with your you know, Eddie's awesome unconference, you know, Emmanuel's like got this awesome unconference, and then there's that other, you know, awesome unconference that you want to go to. So what we're going to do is we've created a Google Drive folder, okay? So for each day, there is a folder where each session, and this is going to be a, you know, our one major rule for the unconference, each session should have a note taker, and each session should have a report back person. Okay, so just assign that at the beginning of your unconference, and then go into that Google folder, it's shared with everybody, create a Google Doc, title your unconference, and take notes on your session, okay? So that way, all of the unconferences will be documented through that structure. And what's gonna happen is, Sunday at 5 o'clock, when we do our closing, we're gonna do report backs. Every single session, and we'll do a little math to figure out how much time it'll be, but we'll give everybody like 1 or 2 minutes to report back on that session. Okay, but everything should be documented through that Google Drive folder. Does that sound good? Reasonable? Sarah.
I have just a similar question. I'll try to yell, but...
Oh, no, you got a mic coming to you right now.
Okay, thank you. I just have a similar question to Eddie's, and I was, you know, we were asked to pick hands-on labs, and
yeah.
I chose my top five, which I wanted to do all of them, but okay, I only had five choices. But I have no idea, zero idea if which ones I'm in and where they're at.
Right, right. So, and again, this is my fault. I know I sent you guys a barrage of emails. Every like, I don't know, 24 hours, I'll send you an email at like 4 a.m, so sorry. In one of those emails, there is actually the full workshop schedule. So, whereas, I don't know if Monty is here right now or if he has gone to the wet lab, but it's, let me think of which email it is. What'd you say? Almost there. Okay, yeah. So you can search for it in your inbox. There's an email that has subject almost there on it. I will repost it someplace more obvious. What's the best way to do it? So again, one of the logistical challenges with you guys is, you know, again, not everybody's on the Facebook group, not everybody's in the WhatsApp group, not everybody answers their email. So it's hard to kind of converge on all of it. I'm trying to think, maybe we should just do suggestions right now. Are you guys all checking your email this weekend now? Like, can I send you all an email and will you receive it? Yeah? Yes? Okay. Then what I'm going to do is actually, we created a Google group, and this is actually really funny. Again, shout-outs to my sister. You know, Google actually only allows you to add, like, 10 people at a time and 100 people a day. And, like, the more people you try to add, they, like, increase the difficulty of, like, the I'm not a robot. You know, they make the test harder and harder. It was really effing frustrating because we were trying to, you know, last minute make this Google group, and I was like, wow, Google is not letting us do this. So by now, I think we will be able to add you all to that Google group. So what I'm going to do in a minute is I'm going to send out an email with the updated workshop schedule. So how that has worked is, you know, again, through all of your preferences, we tried to give everybody your top preferences. The schedule is out there. And again, it's just sort of like the tours on Thursday. If you don't want to do a conference anymore or an activity anymore, just take your name off of the list. It opens up. You can add your name to the list. And Monty also made little boxes for a wait list so you can bump yourself up. Okay. And yeah, and that's basically what we're going to do tomorrow is we're going to let people know when the unconference is happening, or sorry, when the hands-on activity is happening on stage. And then your instructor, again, each instructor is paired with an MIT person. They'll just be in the back of the room and they'll take that group out. And we'll cross the street and we'll do it that way. Does that make sense? Does that sound good? Reasonable? We'll try it. If it starts failing, you know, feedback, we can make real-time adjustments. Cool. Other questions? These are very good questions. I'm glad we can talk about this now that we actually have some time. Patrick.
Since we're talking about sort of the prehistory of DIY Bio, I would love to make a timeline of what's been happening in this field for the past 10 years. So we might dedicate another wall or maybe a whiteboard or something to just go from 2007 to 2017, highlight everything that's been happening. And all of the community labs can put their own sticky on there and say when they first started meeting and when they opened the lab and things like that.
Do it. Sounds awesome. Do you have a wall for that picked out, Patrick? Actually, the wall on the opposite of the Golgi complex, that auditorium right there, is blank right now. I think that's a great wall for it. Go for it. Cool. Anybody else? Questions, comments, concerns? Is everybody having a good time so far, by the way? How are you guys all feeling out there, yeah? I personally am just like, I just can't believe this is happening, man. You know what I mean? This is like, you guys are all here. Just Hello World like made me cry like Purple Rain tears. It was so beautiful. So happy. Michael, my dude.
Yo.
Yo.
I just want you to know how much, and I speak for the group, how much we all appreciate what you've done.
Oh, man.
And Mary, wherever you've run off to, that what you've done to bring us all here and make this happen, and thank you so much.
Oh, dude, thank you, man. Really, it's all...
You rock. You're beautiful.
No, shouts out to all of... I mean, I'm going to do a bigger thank you thing on Sunday, but there are so many people that were involved in this, from the people, like, so many of you came that had, like, visa letters and things that needed to be processed. I mean, there were just... I don't even know... I've got a whole master list of all the people that need to be thanked, but it's a huge, huge list. So really, shout outs to all of the organizers for all of your incredible work, because, you know, again, it wouldn't be possible without you and you in the room just investing in this movement. I'm going to call it a movement. And being here, so thank you guys. Any other questions, comments? If there's no other questions and comments, I think there's nothing else that people like than just to chill and kick it. So hang out, guys. We have 15 minutes until lunch arrives at noon, and then we're gonna have an hour for lunch, so you guys gotta have a solid hour and 15 minutes off. But come back at 1 o'clock sharp, and I'm going to ring the bell fiercely for this, because the sessions in the afternoon are going to be really, really amazing. So the first session in the afternoon is a diversity inclusion session. I don't know if y'all know Stephanie from, I'm going to get the country that she is in wrong. I think she's in Austria. I don't know if anybody is friends with Stephanie, but her talk, Feminist Perspectives on Biotechnology, she had that unconference. I think that was the most popular unconference in the entire unconference document. I've been talking with Stephanie. She unfortunately couldn't join us in person, but we're going to use technology and Zoom her in. Stephanie is going to give an amazing, amazing talk. We've got Thomas here from Cameroon. Where's Thomas? I don't know if Thomas is in the room right. Shout outs to my dude, Thomas. Everybody make some noise for Thomas right here. Cameroon is in the house. Thomas wrote a really, really awesome paper, actually. I think a really, really great critique of the maker movement. I highly recommend you guys all read it. And so Thomas is going to give a really awesome talk about biohacking in Africa. And then a really, really special guest. Her name is Alicia Wooten. I met her at the March for Science, or saw her speak at the March for Science. So she in Boston, and she is a PhD student at BU. She also happens to be deaf. And she is going to give a talk about accessibility. So I know for me, you know, I like to think of myself, oh, I'm really into accessibility and inclusion. But I think when you meet somebody as inspiring as Alicia, who really challenges your notion of what accessibility means, right? I think, you know, this movement, we think a lot about, like, how do we bring in all kinds of disparate communities? And Alicia, I think, is really, really going to challenge those notions. So come back at 1 o'clock sharp. Diversity and inclusion is going to be awesome. And then the panels and talks the whole rest of the day today are going to be great, too. So enjoy your time off, and we'll see you at 1 o'clock. Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Thank you.